Today I'm going to give a paper about contemporary Chinese art and cinema based on my research in the past years. Every summer and winter I go back to Beijing, to China to interview Chinese artists and film directors. And in this paper I will discuss their work, most recent work in a global context. Leave this on? Okay.
All right.
The title of my paper is Dispassionate Logic in Contemporary Chinese Art and the Cinema, Globalization, Nationalism, and the Post-Socialist Trauma. As one of the oldest nations in Asia, China has long occupied the so-called fantasy space in the West, Western mind. And Orientalists from the West have intently studied the country's unique belief system and artistic tradition over the past centuries. More recently, as China's economy is growing rapidly, some Westerners begin to wonder if this country will become a new challenge or even a threat to Western powers, especially the United States. In the summer of 2005, Newsweek and The Times, two American magazines, each published a special report on China, entitled China's Century and China's New Revolution. Farid Zakaria, editor of Newsweek International, wrote, quote, China was big, but very poor. All that is changing. But now the very size and scale that seems so alluring is beginning to look ominous. And Americans are wondering whether the China threat is nightmarishly real. In contrast to the Zakaria's cry for China threat, the Times reporter Michael Elliott's account sounds a bit more objective. Quote, if China's rise looks scary to some in the West, from Beijing's perspective, it seems very different. At last, think China's rulers. The world is being put into proper balance. After 500 years during which China fell asleep, it is once more taking its rightful place among the great powers. For many Chinese and Western scholars, however, China's fast economic growth is to a great extent reshaping the country's political and cultural landscape. If a process of capitalist globalization has benefited China's national economy, this same process has also integrated contemporary Chinese art and cinema into the world system. An integration sanctioned by Chinese authorities poised to redefine the nation's rightful place in the global art world. In November 2000, the first Shanghai Biennial, entitled Shanghai Spirit, a Special Modernity, was held in the new Shanghai Art Museum, followed by the Guangzhou Triennial in 2002 and the Beijing Biennial in 2003 and 2005. In the eyes of most Chinese art critics and curators, the 2000 Shanghai Biennial marks a postmodern historical event that signified Chinese authorities' endorsement of contemporary Chinese art, or avant-garde art, which was prohibited from exhibiting in any state museum all through the 90s. In June of 2005, the Shanghai International Film Festival took place, and two prominent sixth-generation Chinese filmmakers, whose movies had been banned by the Ministry of Culture years before, were invited to appear at the opening ceremony broadcast on TV nationwide. On June 12th, the 51st Venice Biennial opened, with its first official China pavilion to exhibit the latest works of the best contemporary Chinese artists, reported China Daily, an English language newspaper published under the direction of Chinese government. Among the artworks on display in the China Pavilion at Venice was a very curious piece, the UFO, created by Du Wenda, who is a 39 years old farmer from the country's Anhui province, who had been trying to produce a UFO of his own since 1999. The press, as well as a large international audience, went to watch the launch of the UFO, whose symbolism was to represent the trajectory of the Chinese economy in the 21st century. To everyone's disappointment, however, the homemade flying saucer refused to fly. There was just a gust of noise. So this is the UFO that refused to fly. In my view, this regretful failure is still a global event that may symbolize it something else other than what Chinese rulers have currently hoped for. In particular, the country's economic rise in the new century, as rendered by the special issues of Newsweek and The Times. Michael Kimmerman, a reporter of New York Times, called the Chinese Pavilion at the 2005 Venice Biennial a disappointment, visually speaking. And he suspects that the National Pavilion was given a handsome space because the Italian government is anxious to trade with China. According to China Daily, the site of China Pavilion was indeed one of the best of all venues, since it was located in the busiest block and next to the press center of the biennial. So said the government newspaper, it was impossible for the Chinese Pavilion to go unnoticed by both passing visitors and journalists. Although the China Pavilion was temporary, the Ministry of Culture was talking with biennials about possibility of building a permanent one by 2007 in order to demonstrate the influence of China's political, economic, and cultural establishment among international art community. If the unceremonious inauguration of China Pavilion at the 2000 Venice Biennial is a bit embarrassing to a new Chinese leadership that is determined to play a big role on the world stage, this unfortunate biennial event may as well reveal a conformist effort put forward by those participating Chinese artists who have grown into a new generation of Chinese nationalism or patriotism in this uncertain age of globalization. Sun Yan and Peng Yu, a married couple, artist couple in their early 30s, were responsible for bringing Du Wenda's UFO to the biennial, as they believed that the object was simply a metaphor for the Chinese farmers' romantic ideals, and that any individuals in today's China had the courage to realize their dreams. However, such young Chinese artists' idealism sounds historically familiar to us. During the Great Leap Forward movement led by Chairman Mao in 1958, illiterate farmers were encouraged to become an artist who could paint and design everything from agricultural product on the ground to a satellite in the sky that should all but surpass a very advanced West. At that time, a popular Chinese expression, launching a satellite, was a metaphor for any economic miracle, such as high-yield crop in the countryside. Against this historical background, the Anhui farmer Duanda's ill-fated UFO seem to convey another metaphor that point to a return to China's socialist past, especially Chairman Mao's somehow upsetting political legacy. However, Sun Yan's and Peng Yu's seeming attempt to revive such a bygone socialist heritage should be considered as a new expression of Chinese nationalism, which I think intellectually confronts what Manfred Steger has termed cultural globalization. Steger explained, "Cultural globalization has contributed a remarkable shift in people's consciousness. In fact, it appears that the old structure of modernity are slowly giving way to a new postmodern framework characterized by a less stable sense of identity and knowledge. In China's recent history, the old structure of modernity consists of a Soviet-style socialism, which had transformed the country since 1949. And which seem to continue to function even within a new postmodern framework of capitalist globalization. Over the past two decades, China has undertaken capitalistic economic reforms, although its socialist political system and the cultural values are still very much at work in Chinese society today. To put another way, the Chinese Communist Party maintained its hold on power by embracing capitalist globalization, but never denounced socialism, as did Russia and the Eastern European countries after the fall of the Berlin Wall in 1985. Therefore, a new trend of Chinese nationalism not only harks back China's 5,000 years ancient history, but also its 30 years socialist inheritance. To me, the whole construction of a new Chinese pavilion at the 2005 Venice Biennial was a nationalistic joint venture by both of Chinese government and young artists like Sun Yan and Peng Yu, whose avant-garde artworks were just banned a few years ago. I'm not sure if you can recognize any avant-garde work by two artists here. Banned by the government. Unified by this post-socialist ideology of Chinese nationalism, the Chinese government and artists of different backgrounds work as one to retain that rightful place in the global artistic culture. Although such a combined endeavor may not be as successful as they had expected, earlier in 2005, three Chinese films entered different international competitions and won top prizes. In February, the fifth generation director Gu Changwei's film Peacock was awarded the Silver Berlin Bear at the Berlin Film Festival in Germany. In early May, the woman director Li Shaohong's Stolen Life won Best Narrative Feature at the Tribeca Film Festival in New York. Later in that month, the sixth generation director Wang Xiaoshui's Shanghai Dreams took the prize, jewelry prize, at the Cannes Film Festival in France. Compared with unlucky Chinese farmer and his artist team at the Venice Biennial, the three Chinese filmmakers seem to have a triumphant in the field of a world cinema that is no less competitive. In content, these award-winning films all refer to China's recent past, that is, the late 70s and early 80s, a period in which the nation had to meet the challenge of rising social turmoil and family disintegration resulting from Cultural Revolution. As I have noted at the Venice Biennial, Sun Yan and Peng Yu drew inspiration from China's socialist heritage in order to realize a humble peasant dream under the gaze of Western public. In their work, however, Gu Changwei, Li Shaohong, and Wang Xiaoshui each look at a Chinese family which is destroyed by a post-socialist trauma, in my judgment. To be sure, in the China undergoing capitalistic economic reform, people have suffered from a rapid political and social transition, which is somewhat beyond their comprehension. As Slavoj Zizek has described this similar transition in the post-communist Russia and East Europe, quote, "The catch of the transition from really existing socialism to capitalism was that people never had a chance to choose this transition. All of a sudden, they were almost literally thrown into a new situation in which they were presented with a new set of given choices. For most of Chinese, such given choices in a post-socialist situation are often painful to come by, which can be seen in the work of three Chinese directors who have gained international recognition. Interestingly, there are striking thematic similarities between Gu Changwei's Peacock It's a part of a China pavilion. This is the Gu Changwei's Peacock. The striking thematic similarity between Gu Changwei's Peacock, Wang Xiaoshuai's Shanghai Dream, and Li Xiaohong's Stolen Life. In these three movies, the main character is a young daughter that is strangely alienated from her whole family. Contrary to this female character, however, is a middle-aged father figure that is cruel to his children. As a result, the daughter hastily marries a man he does not love in order to leave the family. This is Gu Changwei Peacock, that young daughter marries this man she does not love at all. Okay. Or she attempts a suicide. In Wang Xiaoshuai's movie, Shanghai Dream. Or she attempts a suicide in protest of that obscene power of the father. Shanghai Dreams. And lastly, against the will of her parents, she chooses to live with a man she falls in love with, but later discovered their romance is a scam. This is Li Xiaohong, Stolen Life. Both of her fathers in Peacock and Shanghai Dream turn out to be a blue-collar factory worker. And their wives are factory doctor. In this respect, they are all the symbolic figures of a bygone socialist era. The father in Stolen Life is nevertheless a school teacher from the country. I don't have a slide, okay. And he is the least demanding father among others. With such a working class background, the three fathers surely belong to a winning socialist system which seemed no longer to hold the family or community together. Central to three Chinese filmmakers' work is a troubled relational opposition between father and daughter, which is, in my view, a metaphor for post-socialist trauma. In other words, the fathers of a former socialist working class are unable to understand their daughters who have grown up in the so-called reform and openness era. It is a historical trauma that inflicts a Chinese society grappling with the bitter transition from socialism to capitalism in Zizek's analysis. As Chinese socialism is giving way to global capitalism, a once harmonious Chinese family is most likely overtaken by what Steger has previously described as a less stable sense of identity and knowledge, which point to a remarkable shift in people's consciousness affected by capitalist globalization. The post-socialist trauma of transition has also become a central imagery in Chinese avant-garde artists' most recent works. For instance, Liu Jin's Wounded Angel is a performative photographic work that depicts such a post-socialist trauma in a figurative manner. In this picture, a bare-backed young man with the white wings of an angel is hanging onto the eaves of a tall factory building, as if to perch on the very edge of the cliff. And the building's steel pipe emit hot white steam that seem to threaten the man dangling in the midair. Here, the industrial setting is worth of our attention. It is now famous 798 Art District in Beijing, where abandoned socialist factory buildings have been turned into artist studios, commercial art galleries, mostly run by foreigners, music and fashion publishing houses since 2000. So a crucial question should be raised. What is this wounded angel that is clinging to a socialist industrial past in the middle of capitalist 978 Art District, which has attracted tourists from all over the world, including many foreign dignitaries during their state visit to China? The wounded angel is, I believe, symbolic of Chinese working class, which was long glorified under socialism, but is now hastily dismissed in the face of global capitalism. In this context, a web-published photograph entitled Chinese Workers Sleeping Near the 798 District. Should be read in contrast to Liu Jin's wounded angel. It shows such a degraded members of Chinese working class taking a nap on the fringes of the 978 factory complex, which is nonetheless running in part at the present day. In contrast to Liu Jin's allegorical imagery, these workers hang on the very edge of a factory workshop because their entire livelihood depend on this socialist industrial compound, rather than those sleek capitalist art galleries located in the same neighborhood. If a trendy art district or Beijing Soho is born from a post-socialist industrial ruins, such as a 798 factory complex, those who are impacted most in this process of capitalist globalization are that of a Chinese working class. They have become almost irrelevant to a social space in which they have lived and worked for generations. However, after his visit to the 798 Art District, the American critic David Spalding was right to ask this question. Without its own Soho, how can Beijing be taken seriously as a major economic player on the world stage? And he went on to say, Beijing is undergoing transformation at present, rushing at a breakneck speed to smash the old as it attempts to repurpose itself as a cosmopolitan center for global commerce. But the city is caught between two worlds, a past that it is willingly forgetting and a glorious utopian future that lies beyond its reach. So it seemed that in the 798 Art District, this building has witnessed a past socialist dystopia that stands side by side with a glorious utopian future of global capitalism. In a wider sense, this glorious utopian future for Beijing was willingly forecasted by Spalding is perhaps what Zizek has called the last grand utopia, the utopia of global capitalist liberal democracy at the end of history. 9/11 designated the end of this utopia. As a developing country, China is nonetheless embracing this last grand utopia of capitalist globalization, just as the country had embraced a socialist utopia in its recent past. But as I have argued, China's transition from socialism to global capitalism is a historical trauma that has inflicted many in the society, especially its segments of urban factory workers and rural manual laborers. In this respect, Zhou Hai is a Chinese artist who without doubt shares Liu Jin's concern for the wounded Chinese working class struggling in the market economy. His black and white photograph portrays steel workers and coal miners whose everyday existence, this is not his work, whose everyday existence unveiled a harrowing human condition in a China currently praised for its economic miracle. As Eric Ekholm of New York Times remarked on the Chinese artist's work, quote, you cannot just glimpse at Zhou Hai's photograph. I will show Zhou Hai's photograph, okay? The grimy factory workers and the miners in them catch your eyes and peer into your soul as you are drawn into look into theirs. The weary faces do not show bitterness, but they do seem to say, this is underworld of China, of China's miracle, and I exist. For me, Zhou Hai's highly realistic picture series entitled The Unbearable Heaviness of Industry exposes this less known underworld of today's China's to us in the best tradition of documentary realism founded in German film director Fritz Lang's Metropolis. This is a Metropolis, okay. This is Chinese artist Zhou Hai's photograph. In that German silent cinema masterpiece, Lang depicts a similar underworld or the so-called lower city where working class shut up from daylight, the worker tend to monstrous machines. They are slaves other than workers. In spite of this, a French scholar also believed that in Fritz Lang's movie, the working class is portrayed powerfully. A slave dressed in black, heads bent. See it again, heads bent. Anonymous creatures of labor walking through vaulted corridors, sharply outlined in ranks in which the individual no longer count as a human being. And this French scholar pointed out, Metropolis is a drama of the future set around the year 2000. It is those slave workers or anonymous creature of labor that built a highly industrialized and capitalist utopian city in Fritz Lang's Metropolis. Ironically, over and again, we can see such images, machine-like slave laborers in most of Zhou Hai's pictures that are datable to about the new millennium, as anticipated by Metropolis. Zhou Hai himself also made a clear statement about the unbearable heaviness of industry. Quote, industry provides the impetus for social development the industrial establishments upon which modern civilization is built, such as steel making, imposes a heavy toll on those who take part in the process. These people form the very basis of an enormous structure, and yet they are also seen as an outcast, having to endure pain, physical or mental, in this great industrial age. In this country, the road to full industrialization is gradually but surely unveiling itself. There was a time when people on this road felt great pride. Now, a market economy pervades, and so does a sense of a loss and a frustration for the laborers. Here, what the artist referred to as a time when people on this road felt great pride is obviously that of a socialist China before Deng Xiaoping's 1979 reform. So it is conceivable that the same working people or laborers are now feeling the heat of a market economy and overwhelmed by a sense of a loss and a frustration symbolic of what I have termed as a post-socialist trauma. During China's 30 years long socialist construction, one common notion in the Marxist public discourse was that the working class or laborers were the masters of the state. However, this very notion of laborers being masters was soon challenged by Deng Xiaoping's reformist advocates. As Kaplan, Mr. put it, quote, "The assertion that China was engaged in a socialist construction or was in any state, primary or otherwise, of socialism was quite undermined by the skepticism introduced by reformist writings with regard to basic tenets, by their contention that socialism, public ownership, laborers being masters, socialist construction were terms whose meanings had never been very clear to those who professed to implement them. But in that period, the Marxist mastership of workers or laborers had been certainly implemented by artists and the filmmakers of a socialist realism, who, as demanded by the Communist Party, must serve workers, peasants, and soldiers. Well, in Zhuhai's grim but truthful portrayal of the same class of workers or laborers, what we see is a rather dreadful fall from a socialist mastership into a capitalist slavery.
Yeah.
What?
I speak Chinese.
I speak Chinese. He has a question?
Yeah.
So?
你听得国语吗?
我听得国语。
After. 就一分两分钟,
okay.
什么报纸啊？这个《侨报》还有什么？报纸吧啊，报纸没有了，名片没有了，没了，啊，就这一张啊，有，就是，对对，没有了啊。我了，名片，就是一张没带。哦，
没关系，没关系。
好，谢谢，哦，《星岛日报》对对，法拉盛啊，对对对。
我们对哪里都有。
对对，我知道啊。好。
好，
你们忙你们。
Okay. Okay. In 1999 and 2000, Zhou Hai shot a series of individuals and group portraits of coal miners from Hebei, a city located in the central province of Henan. A city located in the central province of Henan, China. In these pictures, black-faced miners descend into a mine shaft each day and emerge from down below exhausted. And the miners work deep in the pit where the safety conditions seem very poor. In several photos, miners huddled in a... In several photos, miners huddled in the hoist as if they were slaves trapped in a cage. It is a dismal scene reminiscent of a bygone colonial epoch. Or symbolically speaking, their daily descent and ascent is in and out of that underworld of capitalist slavery, which even put their lives at a grave danger. It is widely believed that China's mining industry is the world's deadliest, as many people died in floods, collapses, explosions, and other mine accidents. They died in accident, which often headlined in Chinese newspaper today. In early October 2005, a mine accident occurred in Hebei. Where a gas explosion killed 34 miners and 19 were injured and then hospitalized. Among numerous Chinese media reports on the Hebei accident, one begins with such a line: 27 bodies in the coal mine explosion in central China's Henan province have been raised up to the ground. And a web published photo of this Hebei rescue mission, this one, is captioned: "The dead body of the explosion victim is carried out of the pit in Hebei, October 3rd, 2005. Such a news coverage compelled us to wonder if those Hebei miners who posed for Zhou Hai's photos years before have all survived the catastrophe, or have any of them become the explosion victim whose bodies have been raised up to the ground. That is their last ascent from the underworld." In December 2004, Mary Hennock, a BBC News business reporter, wrote, "China's vibrant economic growth is built on coal, the source of two-thirds of country's electricity. Digging out that coal costs life of 15 miners a day in the first 9 months of this year. It is against the background of this heavy human cost that Zhou Hai photographed those Hebei miners who, in Hennock's view, have been paying for China's economic expansion with their own lives." She also pointed out that in China, there are two kinds of mines: big state-run mines, which are generally thought to be safer, and smaller private mines, where majority of death occur. Ironically, the latest blast happened at the number two coal mine of the Hebei Coal Industry Corporation, which is a state-run mining group built in 1957 and is one of the key major state-owned enterprises in the region. As for number two coal mine, it was built in 1958, but was lately declared bankruptcy by the state due to its depleted resources and obsolete equipment. The initial investigation of the number two coal mine accident by the authorities indicate that mismanagement and the violation of safety rules could be one of the causes of the explosion, which claimed 34 lives. To me, such a mine disaster itself is a symptom of the post-socialist trauma, which destroyed a bankrupt state-run mine, which somehow operated in defiance of rules and regulations. As it is well known, these days many of both state and private-owned mines still operate with little regard to safety. This is because fat profit from China's coal mine industry have created some overnight millionaires, including local officials who invest in those state-owned mines and who can prevent safety inspections. For miners, however, a great number of them are former farmers whose land has been swallowed up by China's economic modernization, so that they have no choice but go to down the pit. In Zhuhai's many Hebei photographs, we see miners make such a fateful daily descent with a blank look in their faces, and we detect a sense of luck in their silent stare as they resurface to the ground alive. In one picture, a robust young man carries a shovel on his shoulder, standing against a vast misty country landscape. This natural setting points to a rural origin of those former farmers who are forced to leave their land to earn a living in China's mines that are the world's deadliest. In my view, those miners as powerfully portrayed in Zhuhai's work come to light as a living human sacrifice to the country's booming economy. On the other hand, I think they also emerge as a new type of the working class hero. The imagery that had been essential to Chinese art of a socialist realism from the early 1950s through the late 70s, socialist realism is a Marxist aesthetic doctrine that exhorts the working class as representing a bright future rather than a grim present-day reality. In a 1792 painting, Chinese painting, titled The Mind's New Soldier, successfully demonstrate this doctrine, therefore becoming a most influential and well-loved work of Chinese socialism during the 1970s. In this painting, a pretty-faced young girl is dressing up for her new job at the mine seen in the background. She smiled and does not seem to worry about anything that could happen to a newcomer down in the pit. This cheerful image of a female miner perhaps shows Chinese socialist realism at its best, just as the grisly scene in Zhuhai's unbearable heaviness of industry, which seemed from Industrial Revolution at its worst. Okay. By comparison, Zhuhai's photography presents a reversal of Chinese socialist realism manifested in the mind's new soldier. In Zhuhai's depiction, the black-faced coal miners just emerged from hell. Their eyes, small points of a white, might be there caught in the headlight. In short, Zhouhai's imagery of coal miners revealed the very harsh reality of life in the post-socialist China. Yet his camera treats his subject compassionately. They are the true working class heroes who confront death every day with such a calm dignity. In the past few years of a new millennium, two well-established Chinese avant-garde artists, Huang Yongping and Xu Bing, also approached the theme of death with a similar dignity, but not without a calm. In this sense, Huang Yongping's bad project, and Xu Bing's "Where Does the Dust Collect Itself," have sparked controversy in the global political and artistic world today. In the former, Huang Yongping's reconstructed a U.S. EP-3 spy plane, which collided with a Chinese fighter jet over the South China Sea on April 1st of 2001, which is an incident caused the death of a young Chinese pilot. In the latter, Xu Bing deconstructed a handful of dust. Which the artist had gathered from the street of Manhattan soon after the 9/11 terrorist attack on the Twin Towers. Therefore, the two artworks involved the tragic loss of human life, a very complex subject that few artists can handle with ease. And both Huang Yongping and Xu Bing intend to convey their concern for power that play a significant role in such a tragic event. In the discussion that follows, I first trace an extraordinary development of Huang Yongping's bad project from 2001 to 2005. And then I will examine Xu Bing's "Where Does the Dust Collect Itself" in the context of Zen philosophy and global politics. The story of bad project is well documented in the Walker Center 2005 exhibition catalog titled "House of Oracles: A Huang Yongping Retrospective," from which I draw a brief outline here. On April 1st, 2001, a U.S. Navy EP-3 civilian aircraft collided with a Chinese jet fighter over the South China Sea. The Chinese plane was destroyed, with the pilot missing. He was reported dead later. After the collision, the American spy plane landed at a military airport on Hainan Island. On May 29, 2001, Huang Yongping was on the plane from Paris to Shanghai, where a Chinese newspaper headline hit his eyes. Quote, EP-3 to return to home in crates. At that time, the artist was invited to participate in an exhibition titled Transplantation, the fourth Shenzhen Contemporary Sculpture Exhibition, to be held at the He Xianling Art Museum in Shenzhen, China, which is near Hainan Island. In early July, the EP-3 was returned to U.S. in a Russian-made AN-124 cargo plane, which marked the end of this event. However, like most of Chinese, Huang Yongping was following the development of the story closely, and he decided to make artwork out of this incident in order to keep the event going in China. From 2001 to 2003, Huang Yongping attempted to exhibit his installation, that project in China, which in the artist's own words, quote, looked like a parody or like the shadow of a news event, and reflect an antithesis to the prevailing globalization and Americanism. Yet, strangely, this satirical artwork was prohibited from showing in public due to a censorship jointly and willfully imposed by nervous French, American, and Chinese authorities. It was not until July 2005 that Huang Yuping, that project was displayed at the Today Art Museum in Beijing with an obscure title, The Right Wing of a Plane. Which was part of a larger and official exhibition titled The Wall, Reshaping Contemporary Chinese Art, curated by Gao Minglu of University of Buffalo, State University of New York. The Wall exhibition opened on a hot and humid summer afternoon in late July at the Millennium Museum, Art Museum in Beijing, where I attended a ceremony, opening ceremony, reception. And afterwards, I rushed to the Today Art Museum to see the two monumental installations of Huang Yuping and Xi Bing. To my surprise, Huang Yuping's work was misinformed as the above-mentioned title and received little attention from the museum visitors on that day. With all of that sensation and the controversy created by that project. In the previous years, Huang Yuping's bad project seemed to have lost his power to thrill the audience. As early as the spring of 2005, the Walker Art Center in the United States commissioned that project, which was the most ambitious version of Huang Yuping's famous installation. The artwork was a full-scale recreation of the aircraft EP-3 cockpit, incorporating part of a junked plane that Walker bought and had cut part and shipped to the museum for Huang Yuping's manipulation. However, after Walker's exhibition, House of Oracle, opened in mid-October, 2005, there seemed no critical response to that project from American art world, not to mention any international controversy that had surrounded the work over the past 4 years. An anonymous commentator simply stated, quote, that project is here at Walker. Frankly, this type of work, which involved countless letters, incidents, modifications, actions, and counteractions, all documented with memos, models, photos, and film, can be very boring. A curator of the Walker exhibition hoped, quote, this project will then have the opportunity to be brought before the public eye in order to enhance our understanding of the issues raised by the work and its consequences. Beyond the anecdote of the 2000 military incident, it points to a cultural shift associated with the emergence of China as a global political and economic force. And this curator considered Huang Yuping's work to be consistent, ambitious, and humorous, and sharply subversive in general. And he believed that project is a very complex work. As for the intricate issues raised by the work, this curator did not specify, but what he termed a cultural shift associated with the emergence of China as a global political and economic force seemed to be well illuminated by the Newsweek and the Times special issues on so-called China threat that I discussed at the beginning of this article. Interestingly, a scholar of the University of Colorado In his book, 2004 book titled China's New Nationalism, he actually gave a psychological and cultural, cross-cultural analysis of what he called the 2001 spy plane fiasco. As he wrote, quote, "Culture does matter. Cultural differences clearly played a major role in the Sino-American apology diplomacy of April 2000. But Chinese and Americans do not differ in kind. We are all, after all, human beings. The trick is to capture the ways both cultural differences and cultural commonalities work together to shape international relations. Recent experimental findings in cross-cultural psychology have revealed significant East-West differences, both in reasoning about causes and about assessing responsibility. There are differences of degree, not kind, but they can help account for some of disparate Chinese and American responses to the plane collision." And he suggests that, quote, "Chinese-American policymakers and pundits do need to be aware of cultural difference. Ironically, both Chinese and American policymakers, and French as well, did not seem to mind any such cultural differences as explained by this American scholar. When they joined forces to prevent Huang Yongping's bad project from any public display. To me, such a solidarity between a totalitarian Chinese communist regime and two formidable Western democracy, American and French, in suppressing an individual artist is truly expressive of cultural commonalities, to borrow that American scholar's words, especially in the post-Cold War and the post-9/11 era. In contrast to such a rare international solidarity cemented by the Chinese, American, and the French government, the same 2000 spy plane fiasco evoked different solidarity among ordinary Chinese people. As Zhao Shuisheng, a Chinese scholar at the University of Denver, described in his new book titled Nation State by Construction, Dynamic of Modern Chinese Nationalism. Quote, "The incidents reinforced many Chinese people's impression of the United States as a careless bully that threw around its weight without considering the feelings of people from other nations. With this new incident, many Chinese became angry over American spying, saddened by the death of a pilot, and frustrated by President Bush's unwillingness to apologize. At the root of their complaints was a sense of a wounded national pride. China had suffered at the hands of foreigners before and was not prepared to suffer again. Huang Yongping has been living and working in Paris ever since he left China in 1989. The artist, who is now a French citizen, may or may not share his former countryman's view of the spy plane incident. However, he has defined his bad project as the antithesis to the prevailing globalization and Americanism. By and large, we have all learned of the prevailing globalization through our daily life, but what is Americanism to which Huang Yongping's work is antithetical? By dictionary definition, Americanism means strong affection or support for the United States. In the aftermath of 9/11 event, this kind of a strong affection or support for the United States seemed evident all over the world until the U.S. invasion of Iraq in 2003. Back in 2001, however, all voices of antithesis were hushed by that Americanism in the dominant Western discourse of the war on terror. And Huang Yongping's bad project was just one example of such antithetical voices silenced by what Zizek has described as the restored innocence of American patriotism. As Zizek put it, September 11 was used as a sedative enabling the hegemonic ideology to renormalize itself. The period after Vietnam War was one long sustained trauma for the hegemonic ideology. It had to defend itself against critical doubt until September 11, when the United States was a victim and thus allowed to reassert the innocence of its mission. So the censorship of Huang Yongping's bad project is no doubt demonstrative of this reasserted American hegemonic ideology and the innocence of its mission. Soon after the US EP-3 spy plane incident, the then Chinese leader Jiang Zemin demanded a halt to US surveillance missions near the Chinese coastline, which certainly had no impact whatever on the post-9/11 American hegemonic ideology that persists in keeping the whole world under its constant military surveillance. In this context, Huang Yongping's bad project is an extraordinary voice against America that is at war with the world, according to T.D. Almond's observation. As he wrote, quote, "Nations and people who once saw America as a global protector now see the United States as the greatest threat to civilized human values currently at large in the world." In the pre-9/11 era, a Hollywood summer blockbuster film titled Enemy of the State, which was released in 1998, had already criticized this America at war with the world and even with its own people. In the movie, a former intelligence expert spoke of a worldwide surveillance